Hello everyone, Taki here. Last year I did a video on a new Switch emulator for Android that came out of nowhere. The emulator launched with an unassuming telescope controller that came with a rather interesting gimmick that you needed to own it to use the emulator. Since I made that original video, higher performance Android phones have come to market and the aforementioned controller had a much needed revision to fit them. After I finished making that video last year, I thought two things would happen. First, that we would see the release of a free and open source emulator that did not require a gimmick to function, since we already had a working proof of concept that Switch emulation was possible. And second, that the emulator that was tied to the controller wouldn't see any meaningful development as time went on and diminishing controller sales couldn't justify continued work on a closed source project. I was wrong on both of those points. You are going to see for yourself in just a moment, but I want to emphasize that owning a real Switch is still the best way to enjoy Switch games with current software and hardware that we have access to. They are cheaper than the hardware you need for emulation, and you get to support people that are actively working on these games right now. I think there are two big reasons why people look toward emulating this current gen system. The first reason is the high price of the games themselves, as many popular games that people want to play have maintained their initial MSRP for years. The second reason, at least until the OLED Switch starts shipping, is the dated screen technology in the Switch Lite and the regular Switch. You can get substantially better picture quality emulating Switch games on current gen phones, and this situation is only going to get worse if upscaling becomes a reality. Unlike the first video that I did last year, I want to take a look at the current state of Switch emulation using a larger variety of processors. In front of you are four generations of Snapdragon processors. We have the 845 in the Odyssey handheld. From there, we go to the 860 or 855 Plus in the X3 Pro. I've actually had higher single core performance than this before, but this is all I was getting from Geekbench using the latest OTA firmware. Up from here, we have the 870 and the Axon 35G. And finally, we have the 888 and the Red Magic 6. GPU performance varies widely with these chips that I have here, with some underperforming what should be possible based on Geekbench data. Our first two processors are pretty close together, but we see an exponential increase from 860 to 870 and from 870 to 888. My Red Magic 6 score is nowhere near the maximum score that I've seen for this OpenCL test, but this is the best that I was able to get on my phone. In this video, we're going to take a look at a collection of 5 games to benchmark the power of the processors and how feasible it would be to use them for Switch emulation. The first game that we're going to look at is one that can run on all four processors. Let's start off by taking a look at Hollow Knight on the 845. I have placed an enlarged overlay of the FPS counter on the top of your screen to make it easier for you to see the performance of each game. As you see, we are starting off in the mid to high 30s on the 845, which is easily playable, but we have a huge performance increase jumping over to the 860. On the 860, we are floating around 50 FPS with some dips into the mid 40s depending on what is happening. On the 870, we are comfortably around 60 FPS with little variation. If you switch over to the 888, there's almost no difference between the processors except for a lower GPU load. That game ran well even last year, so let's change over to a more demanding title. Here's Let's Go Pikachu on the 860. The first thing that you're going to notice is that we are under 20 FPS for most of this beginning area. This game is a title that is playable even on an 845, but you will have to put up with some massive slowdowns outside of battle. Once you are in battle, you will see FPS start to sit around 30. On the 870, you'll see that our FPS inside town is significantly better than before. Just like Hollow Knight, there isn't a drastic performance increase going to the Red Magic 6. For this next title, let's go for something that requires a lot more power. Here's Breath of the Wild on the X3 Pro. The first thing that you'll start to notice is that this game is super broken on this emulator. The screen is going to flicker frequently, and Link will start to sink whenever you stop moving. Fighting enemies is also very difficult because they have a tendency to fall through the floor if you do not kill them fast enough. This alone makes this game not worth playing. On the Axon 30, you should notice that the game is running much better, even though we are still capped at a low 15 FPS. We still have screen flickering and the syncing issue to deal with, but the sound is much better, especially when Link gets his first message from Zelda. There's not a huge increase in performance going to the Red Magic 6, but we have less screen flickering to deal with. One thing that I want to point out is our rather high GPU usage on both the 870 and 888. I'm not sure how much more performance can be eked out with software improvements in this emulator, but this game runs with ease on something like the Aya Neo with probably the same battery life as these phones playing this game.
Head for the point marked on the map in your Sheikah slate.
Now let's take a look at Pokemon Sword running on the X3 Pro. This is a game that I filmed last year on the 865, but it suffered from frequent crashes. That issue seems to have been resolved a long time ago, and performance is not that bad even on an 860. There are areas in the game that are going to run slower than this, but you should have decent performance in battles just like the previous Pokemon game. Strangely enough, the Axon 30 actually had the best performance of the three phones running this game. On the patch of the first house, we are around 25 FPS, with 30 in the house itself. Walking down Route 1, we go down to the low 20s before picking back up again. We also have very good FPS in the cutscene that plays. On the Red Magic 6, we are a few FPS worse on the first path to the house, with no real difference in the house itself. Walking down Route 1, we go under 22 FPS, and we have slightly lower FPS in the first cutscene. I checked and this was not due to thermal throttling. Next up, we have Super Mario Odyssey on the 860. I'm actually going to cut this clip shorter than the other two because the performance is really bad, both in FPS and in sound quality, but I did want to show off how low the FPS gets in these scenes. The FPS is also not that great on the 870, and we are basically maxing out the GPU to get this performance. The sound, however, is improved over the 860. I have to stress that this is just a generalization, as there are areas in this game that are too demanding for any processor you could use. On the Red Magic 6, we have a slight boost in FPS over the 870 while also maxing out the GPU. For our final game, we have Monster Hunter Stories 2. I'm actually going to let this footage play out while I close out with some of my thoughts. As you can see, performance with this emulator has improved since last year. Even though we have access to two new Snapdragon processors since last year, many games are still out of reach. It is also hard to know at this point how much performance is left on the table due to lack of optimization in the emulator itself. The only competition for this emulator right now is in the open source Skyline emulator. Currently, that emulator does not display any graphics, so it's hard to see if it's going to be better than this one. This is a larger topic for another video, but the unfortunate problem is that even if they are able to release a better emulator to compete with this one for free, the team behind this emulator will probably just steal their work and profit from it. Given the high cost of hardware needed to run this emulator well, you are still better off just buying a new or used Switch if you want to play Switch games. Anyway, let me know your thoughts on this issue. Do you think we will see any big improvements going forward? Will we ever get to the point where an 860 can perform like the 888 does at this point? Let me know down below. I'll catch you here next time with another video. Happy gaming, everyone. Taki out.